In that sense, of course, these quotations which Shobindu gives here from his Secret of the Veda are very important for us. So to establish this understanding of etymology, we have to go to embryology of language. And that's what he says here, the true science, the true method of science is to go back to the origins, the embryology, the elements and more obscure processes of things, from the obvious only the obvious and superficial results. That's where we are now today with our etymological theories. The profundities of things, their real truth, can be best discovered by penetration into the hidden things that the surface of phenomena conceals, into that past development of which the finished forms present only secret and dispersed indications, or into the possibilities from which the actualities we see are only a narrow selection. This is what we have to keep in mind when we are examining the words today. A similar method applied to earlier forms of human speech can alone give us a real science of language. Law and process must have governed the origins and developments of language. Given the necessary clue and sufficient data, they must be discoverable. It seems to me that in the Sanskrit language, the clue can be found. The data lie ready for investigation. This I like very much. So he takes Sanskrit language as the formation of this new science of language, yes? So to say speech, word. I would say word is the best, neither speech nor language.
Did he have if I may interject, did he have a term for that, or just the word, basically?
He spoke about, a new science of language. Here it is, a real science of language.
Okay.
And he says that without this etymological depth, we have no science of language. It's all wishy-washy. It's all comparing one form with another form, endlessly comparing forms and possibilities. There's no real science because there is no depth. And I totally agree with him because I studied especially general and theoretical linguistics in the university. And I must tell you, it is so superficial. So on the surface, all infinite forms are compared to infinite forms, and that is stuck there. There is no conclusion, there is no depth of knowledge, there is no intuition, there is nothing. Forms compared with forms.
And here, you can make conclusions because you've looked at the base, the formation of it, or the essence of it.
Right. Here you are subjectively involved, as it were. Okay. You are becoming part of this psychology. You are becoming a creator of the word. This very power of the word becomes your property or your capacity. And then you start understanding what rishis were doing. Otherwise, what could we understand? We can only, with our mind, superficial mind, compare forms with forms.
Yeah, otherwise it's purely academic, right? Yeah.
Academic, in the best sense, what we can get out of it, yes.
Yeah.
Because academia also has its strength, but truly speaking, it's very flat, very wide, very horizontal. It goes all horizontal.
That's you don't have to, twist my arm on that one. Absolutely, that's a job. That's where it falls short.
Yeah, and it is endless. It is endless. You can write articles forever, about things and comparing forms, and that's what they do. And it's actually some kind of, also it's necessary to a certain extent, kind of to be precise with forms, but not just exclusively with that. That has to be, there must be something more.
Yeah. They're only scratching the surface and they're not really digging down.
And they don't want to dig down.
They don't. They don't. And they don't like it when you tell them they should.
Yes.
Or suggest.
Yeah, they say it's subjective. So yes. The problem is that with this third person inquiry, this scientific method, yes, is that it never allows you truly to be involved, so to say. Mm-hmm. You have to examine things as they are, as if they are not, they have nothing to do with you. Mm-hmm. I remember when I studied in the university Sanskrit, my Sanskrit teacher told me, Vladimir, you don't have to be so much engaged, you know. To know the fish, you don't have to be the fish. I remember.
And I
disagree 100%. To know the fish, you must become the fish.
Yeah.
You can't know the fish. I cannot dissect the fish and see and know the fish. There is no way for me to know the fish otherwise.
Yeah.
Only to become it. Mm-hmm. So this is the major thing. This we read about the vowels. I will not read. It's very important for us, of course, because it gives us levels, sthanas of articulation, which we will use for our investigation. And our sound, I already spoke about this. I will read only these few important things. The Rishi's use of language, that's what we have to look into, was governed by this ancient psychology of the word. When in English we use the word wolf or cow, we mean by it simply an animal designated. We are not conscious of any reason why we should use that particular sound for the idea, except the immemorial custom of the language. And we cannot use it for any other sense or purpose, except by the artificial device of style. But for the Vedic Rishi, Vrika means the terror, and therefore, among other applications of the sense, a wolf. So the wolf is a terror. Dehenu means the fosterer, nourisher, and therefore a cow. But the original and the general predominates. The derived in particular is secondary in the mind of the Rishi. This is very important. This is the very methodology we will be using by reading Sanskrit texts, by Vedic texts. Mm-hmm. The general predominates, the root meaning predominates over the contextual meaning applied to Dhenu, Vrika, and so on, or Ashva. If we take Ashva, it is from Ashu, to be swift. This is a swiftness. As Nirukta would say, Ashva is running. He disputes, you know. Yaska disputes this name with Ashva. Why running? Why Ashva is running? Can we say that everybody who is running Ashva is everybody the horse who runs?
Right.
And then he comes to a very interesting conclusion, saying that actually this general meaning, significance of swiftness, of running, is not applicable to everyone to designate the person, the personality, the thing. It becomes stuck to a particular, person or form or name or kind of phenomena. And in that way, it becomes representative of that thing. Yeah. So Ashvaha for us is only the horse. We don't think about swiftness or running anymore. So this name of being swift or running becomes Ashva for us in our mind. So we fixed one quality to the name to designate it. Yeah? So this is also very important for us to see that all the names we are using for the things are actually partial qualities or representatives which got stuck to those
objects.
And these objects or things can have many names. That's why we have synonymia. We have synonyms. We can call the table in many different ways, but not anymore. Table is table all the time. in English especially. It narrowed down the meaning. Every word is designating only one particular thing. Mm-hmm. Although we have a table of contents or something like this. Yeah. So there is still kind of a difference or different usage of the same word. So if we go to table closer, look closer to this word, we come to tabla, to this, you know, to the Latin, and we will see that it has something to do with flat piece of something, yeah, like wood.
Right.
Yeah, and that's why table of contents, that's why table which is flat. So that flat surface is one quality of the table, which can designate or name the table. But in Sanskrit, you can have utpitika. Utpitika is upliftment or elevation. Yeah. So upliftment of elevation is also table. Why not? Right. But not always, not only, but any other upliftment also can take place somewhere else with other things. This freedom of mind and meaning, we have to get back to ourselves. We have to think in those terms of the roots, where the general predominates and the secondary is only derived there. So we have to get that freedom of naming things as we want them to be named. And the last thing, the Vedic Sanskrit abounds in a variety of forms and inflections. It is fluid and vague, yet richly subtle in its use of cases and tenses. And on its psychological side, it has not yet crystallized, that's what we are talking, is not entirely hardened into the rigid forms of intellectual precision, where the mind dominates. Only one form is accepted for table. The word for the Vedic Rishi is still a living thing, a thing of power, creative, formative. It is not yet a conventional symbol for an idea, but itself the parent and former of ideas. The word is the parent of idea, the former, the parent. It's an important thing because the word may generate things and ideas. Contextual meanings and precise formations are the result of this power of articulation of the meaning, sounding it within oneself. It carries within itself the memory of its root, is still conscient of its own history. These are very important quotations, I think, for us to start really examining it and to have that freedom.
Right. It's the drilling down and being tapped into the essence of it, I guess, and the bhava, maybe the bhava of the whole thing. Is that a way?
Bhava. Yeah. Bhava, and in more than that, there is some articulation taking place. We are aspiring to articulate particular meanings. This is weird. They are very general meanings, like, let us see also one more here, which will conclude maybe this topic in a nice way. Each word had a general character or quality, guna, in the Vedic language, which was capable of a great number of applications, and therefore a great number of possible significances. This is what we find in the dictionary. If we take word yoga, we will find more than 150 significances in Monier Williams. And the list is open. Why? Because this general significance can create meanings. We can create words. We can apply this yoga to any particular context and create a new meaning. So, and this guna, and its results, it shared with many kindred sounds. At first, therefore, word clans, word families started life on the common communal system with a common stock of possible and realized significances and a common right to all of them. Their individuality lay rather in the shades of expression or the same ideas than in any exclusive right to the expression of a single idea. That's what we see in the dictionary. When we read word by word,
right,
the meanings do not change. They kind of shift slightly, like with a sound.
Yeah, and if I may, is like when you look in the dictionary, and of course there's just for the actual root or mean the word itself, but then they, of course, start to add the, you know, compound it with other words and how it's still that essential meaning is flowing through as these other words are added on to, it's the same.
Yeah. Or even if you change, we can open the dictionary and see. Unfortunately, we don't have the dictionary in that way as it is printed. But if you see article by article, page by page, the sound is changing slowly. New words are coming, but they're also beginning with the same root, so to say. Yeah. You will see that the meanings will not go away. They will be slightly changing here and there, here and there. So you will stay within the same core meaning.
Yeah.
Which is not the case in English. If you open the English dictionary, you will see that from word to word, meanings are totally changing.
Yeah. Yep.
That means a rigid intellectual precision is already... has already taken place. So the principle of partition was at first fluid, then increased in rigidity, that's what we are talking about, until word families and finally single words were able to start life on their own account. For in the first state of language, the word is as living or even a more living force than idea. Sound determines sense. In its last state, the position have been reversed. The idea becomes all important, sound secondary. So this is the shift from one paradigm to another. This is what I wanted us to see before we enter into this kind of study. So if you look at our alphabet, we could see that this is a primary etymological system of all possible articulatory devices. Yeah. And we spoke about it already. So if this R, E, R, L, U on the five levels, so we could see that the first simple roots would be of the same kind. If I take ka, kha, ga, gha, na, ha, and kha, there is no root, it's only at the end. So what the k and a, the first combination would be the purest combination, should be ka, or short or long, kha, short or long, because a, short and a, long, do not change dramatically the meaning. They add some kind of flavor to it, some kind of...
spice it up a little, maybe?
Yes, they do something to it, and we could look into it, what long and short vowels do, how they... But they're intensifying the meaning or prolonging the same kind of power. And if we add nasals to it, like kan or kam, kam root, kam, kama, kama te, kama yate, then khan to dig, and gum to go. This nasalization is also very interesting. It or gun, gana, to. So we will see this the simplest way, which is not too much interfering into the major significance of the syllable. So I'm not examining them. I'm just bringing the first idea. We will come to that list and look into it. But if we take cha varga, cha cha ja jhanya ya sha, And I must add E to it to have a pure root. Yeah, so it should be chi chi ji ji ni yi shi, so to say. Yeah. So and these would be, if we figure out these significances, we would see any other deviation or derivation if we choose different vowels. But first we have to choose pure vowels, so to say. Yeah. So on the same level. So chi is chi palatal and e palatal, we stay in the same position of middle tongue touching the palate. Chi, chi, ji, ji, ni, yi, shi. So some roots are like ni, yi are not available, yes? So to say. And but shi is available, ji is available, chi is available. So if, and e is available, e is to go, to move. And chi would be is to focus our concentration upon, to focus, to concentrate, yeah, to gather, to pile up to one spot, yeah, to bring everything, all attention to one spot, not this kind of dispersed or vast attention to everything, but kind of focusing on one particular thing. So from here, chinute, chinoti, yes, to focus, to think, or to be conscious of, to concentrate. From here, chit, consciousness, and ji also to conquer, but also conquer not in the sense how we understand it. We imagine conquering as war or something. Ji is more why they say, for example, svargam jayati, he conquers heaven. How can you conquer heaven? Satyam eva jayate, prevailing, conquering. So to say, I was imagining that ji has this more pervasive, very powerful intrusion and occupation, first breaking through and intruding and occupying. So to say, you know, that was the idea of, in my mind, of ji.
Could you apply that also to the mind overcoming mental challenges, then would be the same. In the same context.
Prevailing, yes, prevailing and conquering, yes, weaknesses and so on. Yes, we can apply it to any context, in the mind, in the vital, in the physical, in the reality outside, in the reality inside. Language does not really make the distinction, we know it, because it operates within linguistic reality. What is interesting also about linguistic reality, that it corresponds perfectly with the reality outside. So to say, the mental categories which were created within the grammar are, how to say, reflecting, or rather projecting, the relations outside. For example, if I take the sentence, I'm going home, so I am going home. Home is my object. I am going. I am the doer. So the same happens outside. I go. Home is there, my object. Right. Mm-hmm. So physically and linguistically, these two realities correspond. I'm speaking about grammar now. I shifted from.
Yeah, I know. It's trippy stuff. Mm. I mean, I wouldn't have thought of, you know, distinguishing between the external and the internal like that. But yes, it's valid.
Yeah. And I can go home in my mind also the same way.
Right.
And in my feelings and mm-hmm. and so on. And elsewhere, yeah. Because mm-hmm. that is the language. So linguistic reality and real, so to say, objective reality have this total correspondence. By the way, this was discovered by Saussure, and he's what we studied in general linguistics, the signified and signifier, come together. the signifier is the word and signified is the object. So that when they come together, they build this sign, what he calls one sign, signified and signify. Every word has two sides to it. What it signifies and the very one. Stuff, what how it does it, its yeah. own reality, so to say. Mm-hmm. Of course, Saussure took it from Bhartrihari, of course, from Vakyapadiya of Bhartrihari and his work on Sphota. But he never acknowledged it. By the way, Saussure didn't want to publish his works. It was published after his death by his disciples, students. Yeah. And I understand why, because actually he borrowed the idea and he didn't want to acknowledge it. And it became the basis for structuralism, for phenomenology, everything else comes later. It's quite interesting, the whole development of Western philosophy and linguistics.
Yeah, when did that happen?
It happened at the beginning of 20th century.
Okay,
and yes. And Saussure was the professor of Sanskrit. We should not forget that. And his PhD was on Sanskrit language and grammar, so to say. And then he becomes the father of Western linguistics, you know, of general theoretical linguistics. Quite interesting. So we have to come back to embryology. That means this. That's what I want to say. So if we look at these Chi, Ji, and Shi, these roots are available in E. Why we need them? We need them to establish something essential for this varna, for this sthana. Once we have that, and it is kind of understood by us, felt by us, then we can deviate and see the deviations, the meaningful deviations. And then pu, pu, bu, bu, mu, I will take one more. So pu is also the root, u is the root, to pervade, to grow, to occupy. Pu is to purify, and from here many words. And of course, bhu, to become, mu, to bind. All these meanings will come in a very beautiful fashion together. We could feel the meaning of this u, and because pu, bu, they're all labial, and U is also labial. So we're keeping the same level. And the Sanskrit roots can help us to figure out that. This was my approach. From here I started. Then I started to compare different vowels as significant, because they're creative of meaning, with different consonants. And everything just fell into place. Everything became meaningful somehow. So I explained my approach, and now we go straight to the roots. If you have questions or you want to clarify something, you're welcome anytime. Yeah.
Okay. Right now it's just...
too much, most probably.
Well, yeah, it's the absorption of the information.
One more thing before we plunge into it, to justify a very interesting point, and I found it recently, and I'm so happy with this. Mother speaks about the usage of the word, how we have to use the word, the power of the word. And this is all passage is profound. I'm not going to read everything, only her points. She speaks about three causes of effectiveness if they are combined. The power of the word is considerably enhanced. First, there are certain words whose resonance in the physical world is the perfect vibratory materialization of the more subtle vibration produced by the thought in its own domain. If we examine closely this similarity between the vibrations of thought and sound, we can discover the limited number of root syllables, this is our point, which express the most general ideas and which are to be found in most spoken languages with an almost identical meaning. The origin of language should not be confused with the origin of written languages, which are of an altogether different nature and correspond to different needs. Second, this is about the roots, the general significance of the roots in all the languages.
That's fascinating.
We have to examine why, because we have this limited apparatus. We have this tongue, teeth, palate, nasal cave, vocal cords. It is the same in all our human beings. So to specifically articulate a particular sound, we have to do to make some effort with the tongue, lips, and that creates this general significance in us, psychological state. If I do ah, it is one psychological state. When I do e, it's another. Ooh, it's another. And there is a feeling, this, you know, two lips involved at the surface two. All this is immediately somehow present within my consciousness when I do it because of my physical device. Apparatus is of particular kind.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's where, you know, I think the most, the example that works best for that is Om. You know, at least when I tell people the breakdown of the word Om, and I don't talk, of course, in this context. And actually, I see that further down. I didn't realize that it's coming up, but people can relate to that, and they can see immediately. Anyway, I don't want to. I just saw that there.
Absolutely, so. Absolutely. And Mother says that Om is a perfect example of combination of all these three points of the powerful sound, or powerful word. So there is a second one. There are other words which have been repeated in certain circumstances for hundreds of years, and which are instinct with the mental forces of all those who have pronounced them. They are true batteries of energy.
Yes.
So they have their own power. If you pronounce this word, it would have power because it was pronounced for thousands of years or hundreds of years by also intelligent beings, for greater beings. It carries that Akashic vibration or historic or time-wise on the timeline. It has its own tail as a comet, yeah, and that all comes together when we use this word.
Yeah.
Mantras, for example, they have power, regardless to whether you are thinking about it or conscious of it. Mm. You just pronounce Sahana Bhavatu and you're there. Why? Because of this. Yeah? Mm-hmm. It accumulated energy. It is a battery of energy.
Fascinating.
And all these two first, they correspond, that general significance and usage, these two come together into one kind of section. And there is a third one, which is very interesting. Finally, there are words which assume an immediate value when they are pronounced as a result of a living thought of the one who pronounces them.
Mm.
You can create your own significance with a word. You can charge it with your own consciousness, if you have it. Yes, of course. If you don't, then the first two apply. But this is these three, if they are combined, Mother says, and then that would be the powerful word. To illustrate what I have just said with an example, he is the very powerful word. For it can combine the qualities of all three categories. It is the Sanskrit word Om. This is a kind of important for us to see, because what we will be doing, we will be examining the roots, the general significance. We will be seeing also accumulated energy of the word, and we will be also trying to use these words in our own way.
Is there an example of these step three, or is it, you know, it's because it's each individual, you can't really say you know, emanating from that person.
It's a poetic way of using. Poets are doing it. They are using the words in their own way, and it makes totally sense. We get a new significance. We get not even significance in the word. We are getting the, what they want to convey.
Yeah.
That consciousness behind it. Though they are using very in unusual way the words. Yeah.
Okay, I get it now. Yeah, it's definitely there.
All right. Okay, now we are coming back to the meanings. I do not know under which Sri Aurobindo did this and how he could really make it. He says that he, when he was in Alipur jail from 1909, he was 1 year in the jail in Calcutta. They wanted to execute him for, he was the freedom fighter. And so, and in that time, for 1 year, Krishna came to him. First, Vivekananda came to him, by the way. In the subtle body, Vivekananda already has left his body. So, then Krishna came, and Krishna, as he says, gave him the knowledge of all languages. So he could, from that time on, he started to do this kind of strange work with language, linguistics and Vedic Sanskrit especially.
It's quite a stretch to go from freedom fighter to getting into stuff like this. So there had to be something pretty powerful to cause him to shift like that, you know?
And right. He in the Alipur jail, he was already Mukta. By the way, he got his Mukti in 1907, 2 years before, because he had this guru, Vishnu Bhaskar Lele, who told him to do one thing, to observe his mind and separate himself from his mind, from his thoughts. And when he is totally separated, to cast away thoughts. That was his kind of technique. And they sat together, and he was with him 10 days. And within 3 days, he was able, Sri Aurobindo, he said, it will be easy for you because you are a poet. And Sri Aurobindo said that I pull myself up over the head, very high in the high silent space. And from there, I saw concretely how one thought comes into my space and another from outside, concretely from outside. He never thought that thoughts are coming from outside. Nobody told him this idea, only Vishnu Bhaskar Lele, his guru. So, and when he saw these thoughts coming from outside, he just cast them away. He didn't allow them to come, nearly physically. And then he said, this silence came down, absolute silence. And that was that's what we call silent Brahman or Nirvana. He saw himself like in the movie, he said. He and others were the same thing, objectively existing. He was not he anymore, his body or his mind. And it went for months like this. There was no thoughts in the mind. And then he says, later it started to come, thoughts. But they've found their own proper place. Things came back, but they came in their proper positionings, so to say, places. There was no more mixture or confusion.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. So this was in 1907, and 1909, he continued his work, his freedom fighting. That was his major thing. And then when he got into jail, he got this, when Krishna came, he said, you see, I brought you here not to be executed. I brought you here because I wanted to have time with you. And he says, I tried a few times to speak to you, but you were so busy with your
fighting
freedom, yeah, freedom fighting movement, that you didn't listen. And Shubhendu says, yes, I remembered suddenly a few times there was this voice coming, and I kind of went anyhow for my things to do. That's how he got into jail for 1 year to have a contact with Krishna, one-on-one looking at sessions. So he revealed to him some secret, because to come to this kind of vision is absolutely unnatural, or you have to have some mind or some vision, some insight.
Yes.
So here he gives these most general significances of the varnas. Of course, it's totally unscientific, as you understand. Science would totally turn away from this. Yeah? They would say it's nonsense. But because they don't accept first-person inquiry method. Mm-hmm. Okay, Ka. Possession, mastery, creation, action. Look at this. What else can you add? Everything is in one Ka. Huh?
It takes some, reflection, I think. Because coming from a total different orientation, and I mean that in terms of, I wouldn't necessarily say third person, but still, you know, not even thinking along these lines at all. So this is very interesting to see how he explains it. And I guess the thing is that in terms of the sort of exploration of it as, you know, looking into some of the texts and some of the ways in which, especially like in the, you know, the grammar, to think about it that way, I guess.
Right. And also like suffixes, ka, for example.
Yeah.
We would examine ka thoroughly and see, for example, if you take all the roots like kan, kam, ku, kri, yeah, with different vowels,
and yeah,
we could see that all these are here, yeah, all of them.
Right.
Kri, action, creation, yeah, cutting, mastery will be ka, kam, kan, and ku. Ku is also a very interesting word, which is from which kavi is produced, yes?
Uh-huh. It
is to call, this call, ku, it's kind of maybe even same etymology. Gu, ku, all these words would be having something to do with the voice and with the expression of consciousness, mm-hmm, or possession, mastery. The word kavi, from here. Anyhow, I'm just first look at ka.
It bears reflection for sure. See how these work.
Right, and if you think about his definition of a, which is also important in this case, absolute existence, being in its simplicity without any further idea of modification of quality, mere or initial being, creative of space. This all kind of comes into ka, varga.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And all of them will have that general, most powerful varna or color, flavor, mm-hmm, significance.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look into ka, just first overview, we could see that it has this aspiration, which makes it more aggressive or more powerful or more prolonged in space. Like ka is touched, and ka is, mm-hmm, like touch, which is kind of spreading still, yeah, kind of moving. So yeah, it would have already this attack, invasion, insistence, attrition, and detrition because of kan, yes, kanati. To dig, digging.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's more forceful, the whole.
Right.
Or, yeah, emphasized.
Right. Yeah, we are not even looking yet into the whole roots, because if you look into all of them, it would be much more interesting to see. Like, for example, ku is to call, to u, to create the space. And from here, we have kup, kupa. Kupa is the cave, yeah? Mm-hmm. Cup, what we have, kup, kubok. Cup, cave, the same etymology, yeah? Cave, coop, mm-hmm. cup, because it has this cavity, yeah. Cavity.
Yeah.
So, and this is from, again, u creates with k, with very powerful possessive or creative cutting action, creating of space. Yeah? Khan is digging rather, not so much the space, but with ku, most probably it would have that meaning also, digging deep or digging. So I will be now creating my meanings, and then when we compare them with the roots, you will be surprised how they would fit.
Come together. Yeah. What about cod? Cod? Isn't there a cod?
Yes, to chew, to eat, absolutely. Kadati. And also, and more, kid. There will be okhinna, yeah? Mm-hmm. We have to look into the whole this, but how to keep it that it will not disappear into the I have to keep the general significance and come to the these. Yes, mm-hmm. Ka is more like that's why he writes attack and invasion, and you know, mm-hmm. invasion in a sense that as a spade is entering into the soil, it's digging, you know, and right. And maybe even more things. So we have to look into these roots.
Yeah, even as you're talking, I'm beginning to see the associations that you're making. Again, it requires further reflection, but I can get a sense of it as you talk yeah. about it.
It's only in a most general sense, yes. And yeah. then we have to use particulars like digging and so on to show us to see that how it is applied and mm-hmm. how it is creating right. the significance. But that significance of kan is not really everything. It's just one of them. Mm-hmm. I have to open the dictionary to see all the significances. Okay. And then ga and ga. Yeah, ga is already voiced ka, which is very different in that sense, because ka is more hard, yeah, more solid without voice. But with voice, ga, it becomes a contact or emotion. That voice changes dramatically things and action upon. So from here we have this ga to go, yeah, the root gum and ga to move, motion, and also all other words like gu to call, simple roots I'm taking. Gi to sing, gri, glossa, language, yeah, to voice.
Yeah, that's for me. That's again the voice, I guess, is a sort of it's not extrapolation. It's intuitive, yet I mean, you can sort of see it.
Yeah, you can
through contact and motion, but still it's a stretching, a real stretching.
Well,
but you can see it. I mean,
yeah, this general significance, it may be kind of not totally expressed in all the forms as we expect them with our mind. Our mind is yes. very, you know, kind of narrowing down the significances and wants to see them yeah. totally applied. But we do not have that connection yet. But once that connection is established, that intuitive uh-huh. or deeper significance. Yeah. Then we would see how they arrived at this meaning of speaking, voicing, and going, and so on and so forth. Yeah.
Yeah, it is a stretch though right now, but I see where you're going with it. Mm-hmm. And I see why you're saying it, because even as you're talking, I can, and looking at it again, you start to see sort of a, you start to, you know, the synapses sort of start to connect there, fire up, if it will, if you will.
Yes, we are not aware of the meanings of the already words which we use, but because we applied them to a particular action in our life, and we are looking for them at them as if they are in themselves the meanings. Yeah?
Yes,
we do not see that derivatory process where how we arrived at this usage.
Yes, yes, I see what you're saying. Yes,
yeah, that connection. If we establish, we will have an amazing space within, mm-hmm. our mind. It's like a spirit becoming alive or something. Mm-hmm. And then whenever you say simple thing like gacchati, you would have a much deeper significance than just simply going.
Right.
That general significance will be still shining or present there.
Yeah, it gets kind of loaded up, mm-hmm. if you will.
Yes, loaded up, exactly. Yeah. So you have layer upon layer.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I can see that.
And that would be very useful for us when we read Vedic texts, mm-hmm. because there they are still present, and they create really the vision, those mm-hmm. layers upon layers. If you don't have them, we would have only surface action or some activity.
Right, and that's why people can't relate to them. Mm-hmm. In a way, because they're not relating, they're just floating on the surface, and they're using just that approach that's, you know, that's intellectual, if you will, or whatever. So mm-hmm. then they can't, they're not, and yet at the same time, they sense something, you know, they sense by hearing it that there's something there, but the acuity of the mind and these, you know, the underlying sense of it, they can't grab onto because their minds aren't oriented that way. So even though they feel something or they get something, they can't necessarily see the connection or the flow, I think.
Yes, yes. That kind of mind, or that higher mind, or the deeper mind, we have to acquire through this mm-hmm. work. That's why we are doing it. We want to have that deeper perception of the sounds and articulations. And all right. And ga is quite obvious. It adds the powerful ga, the voice, as it becomes voiced. And so we have not just action, but violent contact, not just contact, but more strong, prolonged, and hostile action. Hostile action, it's quite interesting way ga is hostile action. There's something there about it. Usually there is no painting with hostile or favorable, you know. But mm-hmm. in this case, it becomes most probably because of its violence. It disturbs the equilibrium so strongly that it becomes a hostile in a way, destructive.
Can you give a root that...
Ghan, yeah. We have this han, which becomes gha, ghanati. Yeah, we have ghatayati, yes, and also gha, mm-hmm. to destroy, to kill, mm-hmm. to strike.
Okay.
Strong motion, yeah.
Okay.
This one is not much use, gha, only in ghan, ghan, as another aleph morph for han. Yeah.
Well, and just going back to ga, not gha, but the like Ganapati, Gana has to do with the you know, the warriors, group. Whatever. Pardon?
Group. It's a group.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Gana with no cerebral. Yes, also.
Gana.
Yeah, well, it's a group which is following the teacher usually. It's,
okay.
Teacher has his gana always in Guru Kulas. It's that's why he's Ganapati, because he's
right.
a group Lord of Vikanas. Followers.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking of the other words like Gora and
Gora, very nice. Gosha. Yes.
Noise and dreadful and
Ghosha, yes. Okay, yes, correct. Sri Aurobindo Ghosh means his name actually. Ghosha is calling. All of these ku, ku, gu, gu will have the significance of calling. It's quite interesting. Calling, invoking, voicing. So if you look into the dictionary, you will find these general significances which are never used. You will not find them embedded in the language. What Sri Aurobindo did, he did a very interesting work, and it's called Origins of Aryan Speech. I have to send you this file. He took all possible combinations, like whatever the combinations, like if with each consonant, each vowel, and each consonant closing at that root. And he saw that we have specific kind of selection from these all possible combinations. And what he did, it was amazing. He changed my consciousness by that work, totally. He says that these roots, which are not available now, it's not that they are not available, they are not used. But they're there at the background as a potential roots.
Floating.
They are kind of holding the system. And once in a while, they may come in a historical perspective. They may come into life, into usage. So not all the roots, not all the combinations are used because they of the economy of language. You don't need to have all the significances to be used. And there is other thing he said, which was striking for me. He says that by every root, he can come or arrive at every possible significance. This is something to think of.
Yeah. Very nice. Actually.
So each one, like ka, can express any possible meaning. It depends in the context in which we are doing it, or do we have that mind which can express actually different words, different meanings by that particular articulation, in that particular application? This is the freedom of the mind which we do not have anymore.
What about in the people that sing, that style of music, that where that repetition of sounds, and I'm not doing a very good job of explaining it, but the, I guess, Karnataka singers or whatever, do they have any awareness? Because they do a lot of these repetitions of sounds.
Maybe they have this sense, sense of it.
But as far as you know, they don't have the discipline of understanding, if discipline is the right word, but awareness of what they're repeating and why they may be repeating certain sounds in certain ways. Do you have any idea whether they're
trained? In my first kind of what I know about them, and I have ever seen them, it's a tradition. It became traditional. It became formation, as Mother says, that which was used for hundreds of years, and it has its own power. So they kind of join that power or use it, rather than they are becoming aware of it or consciously kind of.
But even if they're unconsciously doing that, could you say that? Of course, it's still having some impact, whether they know it or not. The fact that they keep on repeating these sounds, and syllables, and they move all over the place because it's not just, Sometimes it sounds like they're just repeating roots, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, and you're right. And by the way, something is happening also in this in the classical period. There were many poets who are trying to, I will show you this, maybe I will even send you somewhere I have it, and the different verses which are using only one particular syllable, for example, di, and it, the verse will be something like that: da da di du di da du di da du du de da de da. And it would mean that the sage came to the river and caught the fish and something like this. You would not believe it, you know, what they do.
Yeah.
So in a way...
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
In a way, this capacity is there, yes, in the language.
Yeah. Well, and just real quick, so they're doing it. They don't necessarily know, but when you listen, you can go into the zone with that. Mm-hmm. Completely. You can totally get zoned out just by listening to that repetition.
Right. It reminds me of Carnatic. Yes.
Yeah.
Great. Okay, we have to stop. I'm over time already. Kind of carried away with all this. Yeah. Great. Next time we will be more precise. We laid out already something solid that we understand how we are dealing with our mind.
Right.
So are we meeting next week?
Next week we have... we travel, yes, I guess.
Yeah, it's conceivable we could do it.
You shouldn't push. You know, you'll be with family, you don't know.
No problem.
Whatever works. I mean, it might be a little challenging. They have space there, but I'm not sure what will be going on.
I don't want to excuse yourself or, No
need. We are both traveling.
You're traveling and you're meeting that day. And I think it's just a skip next week.
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Okay.
Have a good trip, Vladimir.
Thank you. Thank you for this, for organizing all of this for me. Oh. I'm very, very grateful.
I forgot to ask, you have to send me a phone number also.
Right, I will. Yeah.
All right, great.
Om sarve bhavantu sukhinah sarve santo niramayah sarve bhadrani pashyantu ma kaschit dukha bhag bhavet. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Hari Om.
Hari Om. Bye.
Bye.